This show is produced by the Hartman Media Company. For more information and links to all our great podcasts, visit hartmanmedia.com.
Dennis Prager here, and I'd like to talk to you about Jason Hartman. Now, they conduct educational events with new techniques for making money. Now, if you and your properties qualify, it is a tremendous opportunity to reduce your tax liability. Visit jasonhartman.com. That's jasonhartman.com. You'll be glad you did, and tell them Dennis Prager sent you.
Welcome to the Creating Wealth Show with Jason Hartman. You're about to learn a new slant on investing, some exciting techniques, and fresh new approaches to the world's most historically proven asset class that will enable you to create more wealth and freedom than you ever thought possible. Jason is a genuine self-made multimillionaire who's actually been there and done it. He's a successful investor, lender, developer, and entrepreneur who's owned properties in 11 states, had hundreds of tenants, and been involved in thousands of real estate transactions. This program will help you follow in Jason's footsteps on the road to your financial independence day. You really can do it. And now, here's your host, Jason Hartman, with the complete solution for real estate investors.
Welcome to episode 1798. Today, we have a fantastic guest. We have Tina from the Cromford Report. Now, this is a company that analyzes the real estate market, and we had a long discussion, went into a lot of detail for you about the market, about understanding supply and supply constraints and absorption rates and market dynamics so that you can get a better handle on how to make those all important investment decisions. Also, last weekend, we had a fantastic virtual event. I want to thank you to all of you who attended and participated. That was only our second virtual event, and it was just excellent having you all there. We have such intelligent, ambitious clients. Absolutely love all of you. And really want to thank you so much for your great questions, your great comments, and participation in the event. And all of the Empowered Investor Inner Circle members, of course, tomorrow evening, Tuesday, the first Tuesday of every month, we have our monthly Zoom meeting. And if you attended Creating Wealth Live and Virtual last weekend, you are invited just one time to the Empowered Investor Inner Circle monthly meeting, where we're going to do kind of a follow-up and an implementation from some of the stuff we learned this weekend. And of course, if you join the Inner Circle, you'll be attending those every single month on the first Tuesday of the month at 8 o'clock Eastern. And of course, if you can't attend, if you have to miss one of them, the recordings are in the archive, as well as a whole wealth of other material Inner Circle members get. And of course, the social network and the forum where people post questions and answers and all that great stuff. So be sure to look for your email if you attended the event this weekend, because it has the link to join tomorrow evening. Just register and then it sends you the link where you can actually join. So it's just a super quick registration. And of course, that is included with Creating Wealth Live and Virtual. Now, one of the things that came up over the weekend at our virtual event was this idea I keep talking about of how every real estate deal, no matter what, when you're doing the deal, it always feels expensive. Every buyer gets this touch of buyer's remorse. We all do this. I do it. I get it all the time. Okay. Happens to all of us. It's just part of human nature. We question ourselves. We think, did we make the right decision? And that right decision usually involves whether or not we paid too much, right? And it always feels so expensive. Like the great poem, The Reluctant Investor's Lament, back in 1977, he says, everything is so overpriced. Folks, it always feels that way. That's just the way it is, right? It always feels that way. But every deal is a great deal looking in the rear view mirror, right? When you're driving your car, you look out the windshield, you look ahead, right? And then you look in the rear view mirror and you think, wow, everything is a good deal. You know, you just let a little time pass. And like the old saying, I don't know if it's my old saying or someone else's, but I say it a lot. Time heals all wounds, right? And usually that applies to love and relationships and romance, you know, when we're heartbroken. And, you know, time does heal all wounds, right? It really does, because we sort of learn how to process our emotions and manage them. And, you know, we realize sometimes looking back, it's like that great song by Garth Brooks, right? And I think of my young crushes. You know, I think of the girls I loved in high school, right? That I was so enamored over them, right? But hey, you look them up on Facebook and you're thinking, wow, I dodged that bullet sometimes. And that Garth Brooks song, it's such a great song, Unanswered Prayers. Do you know this song? Fantastic song, because time gives us perspective. Right. At the time we do anything, we think it's like the biggest deal. And whether it be a romance, whether it be a real estate deal, whatever it is, right? You know, it just seems like so impactful at the time. But let a little time pass, get a little space, get a little perspective. You know, how many of you have been to a museum lately, right? If you are looking through the museum and you go up and you look at a painting, and say you're 3 feet from the painting, right? That painting looks a lot different and gives you a completely different perception if you back up 3 more feet. Hey, you gotta socially distance, right? And now you're 6 feet away from the painting. And wow, doesn't it look different, right? You could go up really close and be a foot away and you could look at the brush strokes. But when you back up, you gain perspective on the entire situation, not just the content, the paint on the canvas, the brush strokes on the canvas, that would be more like the content. But when you back up, you gain context because you're not looking so closely. And that's an important perspective. And that is true with the real estate deals. As investors, no matter what anybody buys, whenever they buy, they mostly, 99% of the time, they feel like, gosh, did I overpay? Did I pay too much? But then you let a little time go by, you step back, you gain perspective, and you think, wow, I'm a genius. That was a great deal. Because it's always a great deal in the rearview mirror. As long as you're not buying in Detroit, okay? You know, and I pick on Detroit, but hey, Detroit's even had its run of appreciation, right? As that rising tide of massive money creation floats all the ships, right? It floats all the ships, even in the dysfunctional markets. And remind me, I don't have time to talk about it today because I want to share something else with you before we get to Tina from the Cromford Report here. But remind me, I must talk to you about my motorcycle racing days, because I think they provide a good metaphor for linear markets versus cyclical markets. And really, almost should have talked about that over the weekend at our live virtual Creating Wealth event. When I used to race motorcycles, you know, there were two major classes of motorcycles, and they really give you, I think, a good metaphor for how to invest, how to think about investing. So remind me to talk about that, and I'll talk about it on a future episode. But, you know, I was kind of thinking of that because I was talking engines yesterday, and I went flying, and it was just a beautiful Florida day to go flying. And for the first time, I flew the Diamond airplane. I had never flown this one. I always wanted to. You know, I've flown the Cessna 152, the Cessna 172, the Cirrus, the Piper Cherokee, and, you know, really enjoyed all of those planes. And they all have their very different application. But this one I hadn't flown, and it's I'll call it the sports car of small planes. And it's really fun. You know, it's a center stick airplane, and, you know, it's more aerobatic. Really cool plane. And it's cool. It's chilly here. By the way, I should mention, for those of you in the Collective Mastermind group, of course, our event is coming up this weekend. We're going to be right near Naples, Florida. And in Florida, it is gorgeous out. but it is chilly, 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 chilly. And Tony, one of our attendees this weekend, he said to me on Zoom, he said, "You think that's cold in Florida? That's not cold." And he's in New Hampshire. But what I want to convey here is that I get it that it's not cold compared to those of you north of us. But you might come here this weekend for our awesome collective mastermind event, and you might not be prepared for that. Maybe you didn't pack your warm clothes. It's kind of chilly in Florida right now, but it's stunning. It's just sunny and beautiful, but the air is crisp for sure. So keep that in mind. I just want to make that little public service announcement, because one of our events Saturday evening will be on the beach. We are doing a casino night on the beach. Now, pretty sure we're going to have space heaters and all that good stuff. And if it's too chilly, it should warm up a little bit. The forecast is that it will warm up a little bit. But if it's too chilly, we're going to take that event inside. So we have a plan B, but hopefully we'll be able to do it outside, because I think it'll be a lot more fun. I mean, casino night on the beach. And our event planner that did that incredible fashion show for us last time at the Scottsdale event, he just, this guy, Joe, he just goes all out. I mean, it is over the top how awesome and how high end these events are. So anyway, if you're coming to that, you know who you are. I just want to make that announcement. It is chilly in Florida, but here's the thing. So yesterday I was in the car, which is kind of a rare event for me because I don't drive much, but I was in the car and, you know, I had my playlist from the phone, just picking random songs. And this great song came on that was on my playlist that I hadn't heard in a while, but I used to listen to it all the time. I listened to the song all the time. And it's by one of these incredible musical talents. Now, she did not write the song. And, you know, it's so unfair that the writers just hardly get any credit. No one remembers the writer, right? That's totally unfair, but hey, it's the way the world works. But boy, she could sing it. and it's just her beautiful, beautiful voice. Now, I'm not going to tell you who it is, because you're going to recognize as soon as I recite some of the lyrics, because I think they're so inspirational and so applicable to our thinking about investing and about life in general and about motivation and about taking a chance when it is presented to us. You know, the late, great Earl Nightingale, who passed away back in 1989, he used to say, "Luck is what happens when preparedness meets opportunity. Luck is what happens when preparedness meets opportunity." And that's so true in life, because, you know, there's another great quote, I don't know who it's by, but he said, "Luck is the word we use to describe successful people we don't like." Right? We say, "Hey, they're lucky." You know, they're lucky, right? They just got lucky. Well, Earl Nightingale's right about this, because opportunities come into everyone's life. And those who are unprepared, the opportunity makes them look foolish. Think of all the lottery winners who ended up broke a year later, right? They won these huge amounts of money and ended up broke just a year later. And all the people, you know, you've got that family member who's a loser. We've all got one. I've got one. And, you know, these opportunities come into their life and they just totally screw them up. They fritter them away. Luck is what happens when preparedness meets opportunity. So this great song comes on yesterday, and I was in the car with only the dog, who is not offended by my terrible singing voice. You know, that is one gift God did not give me. I wish I had it. Ashley has it. She's an opera singer, but I do not have the singing voice. I'm okay at speaking, though, but singing, no. Anyway, let me share some of these lyrics with you, because song lyrics just encapsulate so much. They have so much more meaning than the actual few words that make up the song, right? And they apply to investing. Right? We get these chances, we get these opportunities, they come into our life, and we think, "Nah, you know, it's too expensive, the market's going to crash, there's a bubble," all of this stuff, right? And you may well be right about that. But if you invest sustainably, if you engage in my practice, my technique of sustainable investing, and you follow my 10 commandments of successful investing that we went over last weekend, And by the way, those recordings are available. If you didn't attend the event, you want to get the recordings, we'll make those available to you real soon here, okay? But you invest sustainably, all you have to do is wait. And history has proven that over and over and over again. There literally is no time when that hasn't been proven to be true. Okay, you're going to guess this tune in a moment. I'm not going to tell you what it is or the incredible talent that sang it and, you know, the great writers that wrote it, but it's a super famous song, all right? Okay, so think about these lyrics. Each day I live, I want to be a day to give the best of me. I'm only one, but not alone. My finest day is yet unknown. I love that line. My finest day is yet unknown. It hasn't happened yet. It's in the future. I broke my heart, fought every gain to taste the sweet. I face the pain. I rise and fall, yet through it all, this much remains. I want one moment in time when I'm more than I thought I could be. When all of my dreams are a heartbeat away and the answers are all up to me. Isn't that so true in life? You know, we look outside for answers, yet at the end of the day, they're all up to me, right? They're all up to me. Give me one moment in time when I'm racing with destiny. By the way, you know what song this is now. Of course, this is Whitney Houston's incredible, incredible song. The late, great Whitney Houston. She was incredible. And this was written for the 1988 Summer Olympics in Seoul, South Korea. So think of it from an athlete's perspective, from an Olympic athlete's perspective, right? Okay, let's get back to the song. Then in that one moment in time, I will feel eternity. Now think about this lyric. This is incredible, right? It applies to real estate investing. You're a winner for a lifetime if you seize that one moment in time. Think about that one. You're a winner for a lifetime if you seize that one moment in time. Make it shine. I want one moment in time when I'm more than I thought I could be, when all of my dreams are a heartbeat away and the answers are all up to me. Give me one moment in time when I'm racing with destiny. Incredible, incredible song. All right, I won't play any more of it due to copyright concerns, of course. But yeah, that's just an incredible song. I suggest you listen to that song today. There's so much negativity going around. We need some positivity, don't we? Yes, we do. And that is certainly one of the most inspirational songs ever. But there's so many great songs. How can you just pick one, right? There's just so many. It's truly incredible. I absolutely love music. And of course, I'm sure you do too. All right. Let's get to our guest today. Let's talk to Tina from the Cromford Report. She will be here with us again on Wednesday. This was a very long interview, and we've got a lot to cover, a lot to learn about the real estate market and how to understand and predict that market. So here we go. Let's welcome Tina. It is my pleasure to welcome Tina Tamboer to the show. She is a senior housing analyst with the Cromford Report. Now, this is a report with some unique methodology, and that's why I'm really excited to have Tina on to talk about it today. They specialize in the greater Phoenix metro area. However, don't panic if you're not thinking about Phoenix, which a lot of people are panicking in Phoenix because they can't buy a house. But regardless of that, you are going to learn a lot about a methodology for evaluating real estate prices today and in the future. And I think you're really going to like this. So we're going to throw in some specifics about Phoenix here and there. But just remember, everything we talk about that's specific to that metro area can be applied to any market, not only around the country, but around the world. So I'm really excited to dive into this. For those of you who are watching on YouTube or one of our other video outlets, you can see the charts and graphs that Tina is going to be sharing with us. If you're just listening to audio only, Tina, please do try and explain them to some extent for people who are not seeing the visual aids. But if you don't see them, you can always go back to my channel and see them on video as well. And Tina, welcome. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you for having me.
It's great to have you from the Valley of the Sun, my old home. Lived there for 6 years. I'm really excited about diving into this as I've been following the Cromford Report for a while now. You've got some unique methodologies and we're gonna go into that. But I think maybe first you would just want to talk about some of these crazy conflicting headlines, right?
Yeah. They're fun.
They are fun.
So I'll dive right into it then. I just have a couple of slides here to show just a little window into what we're seeing in terms of prognostication for 2022. So Goldman Sachs has come out and stated that they feel home prices nationwide will surge another 16%. Wow. They are specifically stating that we don't have enough homes for the population. And so that's what they're staking that on. Also, CoreLogic came out and stated that they feel that home prices will go up, but very, very slowly, almost flat, less than the rate of inflation, to be honest. So that is also, looking at Greater Phoenix, if we were to do 1.9%, which is what their prediction is, we would actually have to see prices decline in 2022 because we're already going up 1% a month. So, so that would be real interesting. Then you have Ed Pinto with the American Enterprise Institute, former chief credit officer at Fannie Mae, feeling that Goldman is correct, that we're going to have double digits again this year. And then you've got all the way on the other side, you've got Ivy Zelman with Zelman and Associates coming out stating that she sees a pre-crash. And then you also have, I'll go to the next one. You've also got the MBA here stating that's
the Mortgage Bankers Association, by the way.
Yeah, the Mortgage Bank. Yeah, so the industry consensus right now for most analysts are saying that they expect prices to continue rising, but not at the rate that we saw in the last year. So just a slowing down, but not a stop. That's the industry consensus, but the Mortgage Bankers Association and Ivy Zelman are coming out and stating that they believe it's going to be a decline. And so let's go back. What I like to do is just identify what their concerns are first. So Ivy Zelman's concern is A, population and household formation. Population for the country as a whole has been extremely weak over the last decade. Okay. And then she looks at household formation. When household formation is growing, that means that one household could be two roommates, could be parents and children, whatever, splits into two. Mm-hmm. That could be two independent households. When that happens, your demand goes up. But when household formation shrinks, two independent households shrink into one. So independent people get roommates, kids move back in with their parents, or elderly parents move in with their boomer
or marriage and divorces, right?
Marriage and divorces. Exactly. When you see that it's shrinking though, then you see supply rise. Mm-hmm. And so Ivy is pointing out that we're looking at household formation shrinking, very little population growth over the last decade. We should not be building too many homes right now. And she feels that the investors are going too hot into building the build for rent and apartment complexes. And she also says that we've got a lot of different players in the marketplace. It's not all people who are going to be owner occupants. You've got flip investors who are not real demand. You have Airbnb investors, which are not real. They're not real demand. They're not going to live in the home. They're not going to rent it to somebody who's going to live in the home and be a resident. So those are considered false demand, and they can drive prices up. And then if those go away, you end up with vacant homes. And so basically what we look for in terms of red flags, what would cause homes to become vacant? Because that's what causes homes to decline in value.
Okay. Right? So with Ivy Zelman, what you'd have to see is you'd have to see basically the Airbnb market crash and demand for, you know, short-term rentals to really fall off, right?
Yes.
Which would obviously affect the hotel business as well, because those are somewhat related.
They're all cyclical.
Sure. But you'd also have to see nobody interested in doing fix and flips, which has been going on since at least William Nickerson in the 50s, if not before. Okay. So that would be kind of surprising. And for that to stop, it seems like you'd have to have this kind of contagion of bearish belief that, hey, I can't make money on a fix and flip. I can't add value. There's no older housing stock that needs to be fixed up, which none of those things are true, by the way. All of those things are needed and true. And that on an Airbnb, you're just going to see demand fall off. So I can't make money renting out a home as an Airbnb. So you'd have to have wipe out two sort of segments of the market for her bearish prediction to be accurate, I think.
Well, the good news for us is we actually have in Greater Phoenix examples. And so we can tell you what they look like. So good news, I guess, if you want to think of it that way, right. We already saw what happens to Airbnbs when tourism drops off last year.
Right.
We saw immediate increase in supplies. A lot of people listed their Airbnbs. Many people cannot go more than a few months without a tenant, right. You know, a tourist in their property. So we saw a lot of people literally put their home on the market or on for a 12-month lease. So unfortunately for us, this time, though, it was a temporary situation, and we still had so few homes for the people who were here, those homes were rented out pretty quickly.
Yeah.
So on the scale of intercity Airbnbs, your risk factor is relatively low, as long as your population and your housing correlate to where there's a housing shortage.
Yeah, what I noticed about the Airbnb market, and we don't need to talk much more about Airbnb, but is this.
Yeah. That's important.
Post-lockdown, right, I noticed that the Airbnbs that people could drive to and have a different experience and were not in high-density areas, those just snapped back right away. There was no problem with those. But if they were in high-density areas where they were more fearful of civil unrest, riots, contagion from disease, you know, if they had mass transit elevators, those types of environments, they did not come back very well. They suffered. Or destination spots where you really needed to take airplanes, and especially international travel. So anyway, Phoenix wouldn't be very affected.
Yeah. Well, yes, but here's the thing, you know, and to Ivy's point, this is really more of a long-term thing in terms of when would Airbnbs or VRBOs, vacation rentals, have an impact in terms of vacant homes. Right. And essentially when the economy, if the economy were to go into a recession, typically tourism is one of the first things to go. And that's what we expected.
Yep.
We saw in last year, and we also saw it in 2008. But we didn't really have a lot of Airbnbs and vacation rentals back in those days. But the thing is, we're always looking to see where is the risk of vacancy. And if you have an area that you are building more homes than the population is growing, period, the population, the permanent population there, you are seeing, if you're not growing because of job growth, you're not growing because of income growth and population growth, and you're only growing in units because of tourists, that is a risk factor for an area.
I would agree completely.
Okay. So that's more of a comment. Yeah, that's something down the line. Right. But what she's saying is with the new players, iBuyers, flip investors, flip investors only work, that model only works in the seller's market, period. It does not work in any other market. And we have the statistics to show that they drop off significantly if you're in a balanced market, and they are almost non-existent in a buyer's market because you're chasing the market down. You don't like to pick up a home, go below market value, but property values are still dropping. And so guess what? You get to lose money. So nobody likes the flip model in a buyer's market. That's the whole irony, that people think buyer's markets are for buyers. They're not. They are terrible for buyers, because who likes to buy their home and watch their property value decline? Because that's what happens in buyer's market. So
until you get to the bottom of the buyer's market, and then it reverses, right?
The bottom of a buyer's market is actually a seller's market. You like to be at the beginning of a seller's market is the ideal time to be investing.
I agree.
You do not want to be in a buyer's market at all.
Right. But the other reason that made that buyer's market in the first place is usually lack of affordability, which is usually caused by higher interest rates. So when rates spike up, the buyers fall off if they spike up enough, right? No?
No.
Okay, go ahead.
No, so let me go into one of my slides and I'll be able to actually explain that a little bit more. Okay. But before we go there, let me just show you some of the bad predictions. So whenever we get into predictions and people start to take them as truth, I like to point out all the ones that missed their mark last year.
Yeah.
So Zillow last year.
We all know.
Zillow forecasted a dip in home prices in May of last year by this year. And CoreLogic came out last year and stated they thought that prices were going to be down 6.6% from that point, from May of last year to May of 2020. And of course, that was a gross misfire. Even though they adjusted it come October, they're like, okay, maybe they'll just go up a little bit, 0.25%. And they were still a complete misfire. We went up 30% in Greater Phoenix. We went up 20% across the country. So just because they have great data doesn't mean that their projections are worth that much. In fact, CoreLogic predicted right in here is when they predicted that prices were going to decline. And then this is what they did do. And then, of course, now we're supposed to believe them that it's going to be 1.9%, which would actually require that prices go down.
Right. Yeah.
So
very interesting.
So at this point, probably not, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, same thing with the Mortgage Bankers Association. They are pointing to interest rates. And frankly, I don't know about you, I don't predict interest rates. I let other people be wrong about that.
Interest rates are one of the toughest things to predict. If you ask Jim Grant and study Grant's interest rate observer till the cows come home, you know, it's still really just very difficult.
Fannie Mae doesn't agree with the MBA. The MBA thinks it's going to be 4% by the end of 2022 and then up to 4.4 by 2023. Fannie Mae only thinks it's going to go up to 3.4, which is a full percent less than the 2023. And then of course you've got the emotional roller coaster that people reading this go through. And oftentimes I get pulled into a lot of these conversations on Facebook. Mm-hmm. And this individual feels like we're heading for a foreclosure crisis. Now, mind you, not one analyst out there nationally or locally who is predicting prices to decline thinks it's going to be because of foreclosures and the forbearance thing. Not one person. But that is where when big behemoth companies like Zillow make big mistakes like they did, these people think, well, if Zillow's failing, they're going down the toilet, then what chance do I have? The too big to fail,
right?
You know, is failing. And so some people feel like this is just the beginning. And this is the thing. Oftentimes emotions will cause people to make decisions that are not in line with market indicators.
Yeah, absolutely true.
So you have to lean into the math. And so what I usually tell people when it comes to predictions like this, the best thing to do is lean into what you know. If you can't be with the market you love, you got to love the one you're with. You got to know the market you're in. Yeah. And so far, none of our math is telling us in Greater Phoenix that our property values are going to be declining anytime soon.
Right. And you've got some national data too, I want to dive into as well. So keep on going here.
So usually when I hear somebody say it's the forbearance that they're afraid of, again, going back to PTSD from the 2007 through 2012 foreclosure crisis, I bring this up. This is a national chart that shows at the peak of May, we had 4.76 million mortgages in forbearance. From May to November 9th, 3.75 million mortgages came out of forbearance, a 79% improvement. None of them affected our market. They didn't cause our supply to rise. They didn't cause our prices to decline. None of them affected our market.
Right.
According to the MBA, 80% of these people stayed in their home. Yeah. That left only 20% hitting the market. So even that 20% did not cause our property values to decline. So why do we think the little 1 million left is going to have a big impact now?
It's really a drop in the bucket when you're talking about the nationwide supply shortage. That's nothing. And why does someone in forbearance need to end up in foreclosure when there's a market that is just waiting to buy their home from them? It's such a silly argument. I never understood how people made that argument with a straight face. So, yeah.
Well, because again, you're hearing PTSD talking.
Right.
And mind you, in Greater Phoenix, the minute you get a pre-foreclosure or a notice of trustee sale, you have 90 days to figure it out. Yeah. Most properties right now are on the market no longer than 10 before they have an accepted contract.
Yeah, right.
Now, we are a non-judicial foreclosure state. So if you are an investor investing across lines, state lines, you have to understand Florida is a judicial foreclosure state.
So it's really
slow. Non-judicial. Yeah. Takes a long, long time for a home to get to foreclosure and a lot of, you know, expense. So many lenders don't like to go through the expense of a legal battle in Florida. Yeah. It's a lot less expensive here, but
But the non-judicial states like California and Arizona, et cetera, you know, that's actually healthier. When the foreclosures can happen faster, you have price discovery and the market clears more quickly. That's a good thing. In Florida, New York, you know, during the Great Recession, we had these people staying in their house for 3 years and it just slowed the recovery, right?
Yes.
You want prices to clear and price discovery to occur quickly. That's healthy, if you ask me.
Yes. In fact, they called them zombie foreclosures back then,
yeah,
if you remember. So we're still seeing these headlines come up, and these headlines look very dramatic. You know, they're using the word surge quite a bit, surging, surging, torrent. By the way, 20% is not a surge. Mm-hmm. 150% in Durham
County,
that looks really dramatic, right? So let's look at it we're just going to look at Phoenix, okay? This is what 141% looks like in Phoenix, which by percentage-wise sounds like a surge. We went from 61 notices of trustee sale. Remember, this is a 90-day notice. We went from 61 to 147 from July to August. And then October, we saw 146. So if we look from July to October, it's 139%, right? So that to somebody sounds like this is the beginning of the end.
Right.
But when we look at it in perspective, prior to the pandemic, we were about 400 or 500 already. So this could double and triple and not be alarming for our market here. And then for those people who are now saying, this is it, we're going to have another crisis like what we saw in 2008 all over again, blah, blah, blah. That is absolutely not reasonable. We had 10,000 in 1 month. We had 10,000 notices of foreclosure or trustee sale in Maricopa County alone. So let me just put this in perspective for you. We have 1 million mortgages in forbearance across the nation. If we took 20% of them and divided it by 50 states, thinking we're all going to get an even share, it's 4,000 to 5,000 potential listings to hit our market. That doesn't cover 1 month of our foreclosure crisis in Maricopa, just in Maricopa. So in Maricopa County, we foreclosed on nearly 250,000 properties between 2007 and 2012. We don't have enough mortgages nationally in forbearance to actually reach that potential outcome here. So it's just, we have to go up over 7,000% in the notices of trustee sale.
Right.
And that is not, we don't have enough to actually accomplish that. So the idea that we're gonna have another massive influx of properties doesn't work. So
So a massive growth in inventory is what you meant. It's just that you don't see that, right? I'd like to just go back for a moment though to some of our earlier discussion, not on that chart. You can just go forward to the chart you were on. But when we were talking about Ivy Zelman, how she said that the Airbnb is not real demand, and you know, we talked about that. But I'd like to also talk about the flippers and the iBuyers. See, to me, those people only represent interim demand. There is real demand as long as they're exiting their properties to a final buyer for the flippers, right? That's the real demand, the homeowner that's going to stay there and live there. And for the iBuyers, they're flipping to a final buyer. And even for the build to rent people, the institutions that are doing that, if their houses are rented, that represents real demand. So I don't think Ivy's contention about that being fake demand is valid. It just isn't true.
Well, first of all, let me clarify that Ivy Zelman's not actually talking about vacation rental. That was just me.
Right. Okay.
So I throw them in there because they're actually not being talked about at all. And in Arizona, they're not regulated. So we don't really have any good information on them. Mm-hmm. They are a bit of a shadow, if you will, here. Yeah. But let's be very clear about what is true demand and what is not true demand. So true demand is everyone who's here. Every head needs a roof over it. That's your true demand. So if your population is growing, your demand is naturally growing. Now, whether they're all living together or whatever, doesn't matter. They are demanding a roof. Does that make sense?
Right.
And true supply is everything that's built. Apartments, condos, townhomes, single family, everything that's built, regardless of whether they're in the MLS or not. That is your overall supply. Mm-hmm. So everything else doesn't matter. So iBuyers and flip investors, which they're the same, just one's corporate and one's individual, right? Right. What they will do, notice they're not actually in my demand line because they're not true demand. If you're not going to live in the home and you're not going to rent it out to somebody who's going to live in the home, you are not taking advantage of true demand. You're not part of it. And what iBuyers do and flip investors do is they make demand look much higher than what it actually is because they throw in an extra transaction between the seller and the final buyer. So what iBuyers and flip investors do is they don't affect the market, they ride it. They ride the market. And if you don't have true demand, your model doesn't work because there's nobody to buy it on the other end, right? And that's why affordability matters. Now, Ivy is throwing into the mix institutional landlords. Now, they also require demand, but in a way, they are also part of it. So when they buy, they're not flipping it to somebody, but they still have to rent it to somebody who has to afford the rent that they require, right? So that's why Ivy is saying, listen, these rents are going up beyond what the population can afford, and you need to be very careful about overpaying for properties right now or building too many, because you might find yourself not getting the returns you want. So I think that's where most of her hesitation and, you know, stop sign is in the, hey, take a look at the market you're in and make sure that you have enough heads population wise to justify the number of units that you're building.
Makes sense.
Yeah. And so population can be affected by inbound relocation, which some states have and some states don't.
And you definitely have the inbound relocation for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you also have the household formation, which is moving within your market. So you still have the population, but can they afford it? Are they moving in with each other, leaving a vacancy? So when household formation is growing, your demand goes up. But when it's shrinking, your supply goes up. Mm-hmm. And so that's what she's also kind of throwing her, you know, her little caution flag out to. And then you've got the affordability question. So a lot of times, and I hear this all the time, interest rates are going to go up, so therefore prices must go down. I hear that all the time. But interest rates are not the only thing that affect demand. Interest rates aren't even the only thing that affect affordability. In fact, you can have interest rates go up and you can have lending practices loosen up and you will get more demand.
Right.
In fact, in 2005, our interest rates went up to 6.6%, but everybody who,
it was so easy to qualify, it didn't matter.
Everybody qualified for it, and it was 100% financing, so your demand soared.
That's exactly what we were talking about in 2010, 2011, 12. You know, the banks had overcorrected so much, and Dodd-Frank made such an impact on the lending market, it constricted it so much, that even though we had good rates, the ability to get financing was so limited. And you, of course, remember when Fannie Freddie, you know, for investors, you could only have maximum of two properties at first. Then they went to four. Now they're at 10. So yeah, there's a lot more to it than interest rates for sure. And then of course there's employment and, you know, pay and where's that going? Yeah,
exactly. Remember that a lot of that, the people who couldn't qualify at the 3% interest rate in 2011 and 12, were often investors. We had 45% cash, even though we had record sales during those years, 45% were cash in Greater Phoenix, meaning that a lot of your normal people were either having to live through their 7-year moratorium after foreclosure, no loans for 7 years if you had a foreclosure, or a short sale was like three or four years. So a lot of people just had their credits completely smashed. Right. And of course we had 10% unemployment. So you kind of need a job. Back in 2005, you didn't need a job. Back then you did need a job. So the thing is that lending practices, if we were to see interest rates go up today, and knowing how much lending practices tightened up after the pandemic, I mean, imagine this. You've got all these forbearances hitting the market. Of course, the lenders are going to restrict credit. And so they restricted credit down to levels that we hadn't seen since 2014, right? And so now that forbearance is over, and if the interest rates go up, the lenders are not going to have refinances to deal with. And so what are they going to do? They're going to go after purchase. And now all of a sudden, maybe those self-employed people that they were like, they kind of lend to them last year, you know, now they're like, hey, you kind of look kind of cute now.
Yeah.
You
know? You're funny. It's as if the lenders get beer goggles.
Yeah. I mean, but you know, think of it this way too. A lot of self-employed people got hit very hard by the pandemic. They were not getting consistent income. Some people had the best year ever, sure, but other people had their worst year ever. And now maybe some of them have actually recovered to where they have at least 6 months of regular consistent income, mm-hmm, that can now be considered for a loan now that the forbearance thing is, mm-hmm, is done. So again, interest rates are not the only game. And you also have to know your supply. If, mm-hmm, your interest rates go up, but your supply is still really low, you're still going to see prices rise. Yeah.
And we'll be back with a lot more on this topic with this guest on our next episode. Thank you so much for listening. Please be sure to subscribe so that you don't miss any episodes. Be sure to check out the show's specific website and our general website, hartmanmedia.com, for appropriate disclaimers and terms of service. Remember that guest opinions are their own. And if you require specific legal or tax advice or advice in any other specialized area, please consult an appropriate professional. And we also very much appreciate you reviewing the show. Please go to iTunes or Stitcher Radio or whatever platform you're using and write a review for the show. We would very much appreciate that. And be sure to make it official and subscribe so you do not miss any episodes. We look forward to seeing you on the next episode.